So let's take a look at the case study, the world's largest implementation of zero trust, the DoD Cloud Native Access Point. So the DoD Cloud Native Access Point, otherwise known as CNAP, is actually based on a concept called Software Defined Perimeter, SDP. Not to be confused with Software Defined Networking, SDN, completely different. So let's take a look at some of the critical concepts of SDP. First of all, SDP is identity centric, but not just the user. It's also about the device identity and the assessment of the state of the device. That's critical. The second piece is about that implementation of zero trust, authentication before connectivity, dynamically provision what we call segment of one. What that means is each device and user gets a dedicated software-defined network micro-segmented to only get access to what you're supposed to have access to. Of course, SDP is agnostic to the cloud provider, or of course, of the edge and on-premise environments. It's distributed, stateless, and highly scalable. Effectively, SDP provides a single unified security platform for all users, simplifying and improving security, and not just for person entity, meaning people, but also for NPEs, non-person entities, meaning systems talking to other systems, microservices, APIs. The same enforcement and the same policy enforcement point can be leveraged on both use cases. So SDP grants access based on identity. And it's looking at a lot of different factors. It's looking at the people side, the device side, the environment, and the enterprise broader perspective. If you look at the people side, of course, we're going to look at what device is being used, the operating system being used, what kind of endpoint protection solutions is installed on the device, and whether or not it's up to date. It's going to look at role-based access control, attribute-based access control, and even labels for more modern LBAC capabilities. Of course, it's also going to enforce multi-factor authentication as well. Now, on the environment side, what we're going to look at is things like time of day, geofencing, location, and the threat level of the environment and the enterprise at that time to decide whether or not the user should have access to specific resources at that specific time and location with that specific device. On the enterprise side, we're going to have all the context-aware decision-making. Things like different tagging, labeling of databases, all the way down maybe to cell level. And of course, what is the right type of access based on the role of that user, and looking at things like separating and segmenting business systems, operation systems, billing systems, and so on. In summary, SDP grants access based on context-sensitive identity. The connection between the user and the system, whether it's on the cloud, on-premise, or at the edge, is secure and encrypted using mutual TLS capabilities. It is built for cloud-native capabilities, but it's massively scalable, distributed, resilient, and even enables on-premise and edge use cases. So now let's look at how SDP works. Well, it's using the concept of a single packet authorization, SPA, which effectively has a client that makes access requests to a controller. The controller is going to check the context and then assign a live entitlement to the client. Using SPA, the client is going to upload this entitlement to the gateway that is used to discover applications matching that user's context. So here on the flow, as you can see, the client talks to the controller, which talks to the identity provider, which then assigns the entitlement, and then that's pushed to the gateway that will then decide what that user with that device and in that context of the component risk of the user and the device is going to get access to based on need to know and labeling. The gateway effectively creates what we call a dynamic segment of one. It's a network that's built only for this session with this device and that user. So if the same user is connected with two different devices, he is not on the same segment of one. That's a great capability to mitigate and prevent lateral movement of malicious actors potentially getting access or foothold on one of the devices so they cannot laterally move to the crown jewel of the system. And then of course, SDP will continuously monitor for any context change and change the segment of one accordingly. So if you swap devices or if time of day changes or your context of a persona change, then you will see a direct change on your granted whitelisted access control. So now let's take a look at how the cloud native access point was able to be implemented within 45 days in the largest behemoth that is the Department of Defense. CNAP is provided and managed by Platform One, the DoD Enterprise DevSecOps team. It provides effectively a full zero trust stack, enforcing device state using role-based access control, label access control, and implementing software-defined perimeter, which is really based on the Google Beyond Corps concept. This allows access to what we call Cloud One, which is the DoD cloud, which has access to Amazon and Azure and other cloud provider. And that enables users to connect to the cloud without having to VPN first to the DoD network. This also enables different devices to be used by the user based on the needs. For example, from thick clients to bring your own device, to government owned devices, to contractor devices as well. Always enforcing the device state. That's essential. We also allows for use cases using a virtual desktop with VDI options with zero and thin clients. It obviously also brings a full DMZ with a perimeter stack that's still used to protect the perimeter and of course augmented and massively enabled through micro segmentation using zero trust. It has both IDS and IPS capabilities with web application firewall, with full packet capture, centralizing logs and telemetry into an elastic stack. That also enables us to bring a full single sign-on experience with various PKR options and MFA options. All that centralizing of the logs enables us to push it directly to SIEMs and SOLs. So now let's take a deeper look at the network path and how the CNAP is actually implemented. In this case, you can see we have different devices that can be consumed. You can see thick endpoint mobile devices, zero client, thin client, and really based on the device being used, you're going to get access to different things. Everything will go first through that ingress VPC where we have a Palo Alto IPS, which could really be replaced by any IPS. It does kind of the border firewall protection layer 1-7 security, break and inspect the TLS traffic to be able to see what's going on there. It has a web application firewall capability, and really that's the centralized ingress point. From there, it's going to flow into the software-defined perimeter VPC that has the technology that we use, which is called AppGate, which effectively brings that implementation of SDP with micro segmentation and the client side and the gateway and the controller side. This enforces what we call comply to connect, which is really the concept of enforcing the device state based on the risk of the device. It also uses, of course, labeling and role access control to enforce access and provide that mutual TLS tunneling and has these client capabilities that get installed on the device side. So on the device, you're going to see the AppGate client installed to be able to do that enforcement of the device state, replacing the VPN client. So no more VPN. All the stack talks to our Keycloak single sign-on stack, which is open source, to be able to do that single sign-on using different options like SAML, OpenID, and OAuth, and of course has different LDAP and AD integrations as well. You can see also we have a VDI VPC that enables that VDI experience to be able to give access to resources via direct full VDI capability. We have a management VPC that has all the management tool with the SIEM, the SOAR, the scanning, and of course the centralized logging and telemetry. From there, once you're going through that at gate zero trust software defined parameter, you're going to be able to access different resources on different VPCs, different clouds, and it's cloud agnostic. So we have the same stack running on Amazon, Azure, and of course other cloud providers, all the way to on-premise and at the edge by having AppGate controller and gateway replicated on all of these different environments and being able to effectively act as a gateway to ingress into these different enclaves. You also see an egress VPC where we have also the Palo Alto capability there to do the border firewall protection and layer 1 to 7 capability with break and inspect. And you see also that we use Zeek on both ingress and egress VPC to be able to add a layer of intrusion detection capability with full packet capture. Now, if you look at a concrete example, let's say you have user one and user two. User one has a bring on device mobile and a government furnished laptop. And then you have user two that has a government furnished mobile and a bring on device laptop. Based on the device being used, as you can see, the same user could have different access because if you use a personal device, you do not get access to the same capabilities because of the risk of the bring on device brought to the enterprise. So in this case, as you can see here, if you follow the line in the traffic, while the government laptop used by user one gives them access to more of the platform one resources, effectively the mobile device only gets access to a piece of the Office 365 stack. He does not get to see the source code repo and the GitLab CI/CD pipeline. In another example here, you see the user two would have access to the pipeline and the Amazon services on his government device, but on his bring your own device platform, he would only get to see the Office 365 stack. So again, through the AppGate controller and gateway, we can enforce that segment of one and whitelist access to resources, not just based on the user identity, but more importantly to the component risk of the user plus his or her device being used at that time. And it varies, of course, between mobile and laptop, desktop, time of the day, geofencing, to limit kind of the exposure risk of a potential malicious user getting access to an approved device. Each device have an identity using X509 certificate that are assigned to the device and track that way to make sure we know who the device belonged to. There you have it. The critical capabilities brought to you by software-defined perimeter is all about enforcing micro-segmentation with granular segment of one that are created based on the device risk, the user risk, compounded into a single risk poster that defines, based on need-to-know and least privilege, what you're supposed to have access to based on that context. It's not just about identities and keeping track of who does what when. It's more importantly about the device being used with that specific user to make sure we have proper visibility on the devices and the state of the device and the component risk with time of the day, geofencing, and the user identity using that device. This is a key to enable your labeling, and check out our video on data centricity on how to label data down to the cell level so that access control of labeling enforcement can be enforced all the way down to the data cell.